Hi, Mr. Walsh. My name is Luna, and I am a nationally registered advanced EMT here in the state of New Mexico. I am also transgender. Throughout my career as an EMT, I have responded to, by conservative estimates, about 1,500 calls for service here in the state of New Mexico. I have treated more transgender people than I can count. Who will tell me that the support of the people in their lives makes a difference in their lives? And that's been my experience as well. My question for you is, despite all of these transgender people who tell me how great things are for them, I have never once treated somebody who told me that they regretted their transition. Never once. It hasn't happened. So where is this supposed epidemic of people regretting their transitions?
Well, you could just ask them. Are you denying that they exist?
I understand they exist. I haven't seen significant evidence of it to nearly the same extent as people who tell me they're happy with their transitions.
Okay, that's fine. You personally haven't seen them. I have. I talk to them all the time. So I know that they're out there. I know they exist. I also know that, I know a couple other things. I also know that the suicide rate, as we established, suicidality for trans people remains sky high even after transition. And I went over in the talk why all of the explanations for that, that somebody on your side of the discussion might offer, don't hold water, they don't work, which tells us that there's something else going on, and which tells us that there's still a deep despair there. So those people who identify as trans, then they transition, and then they kill themselves, which is a large number, they might not articulate, many of them may articulate this, but they might not articulate that they regret this. But even so, as they say, actions speak louder than words. And so it's pretty clear that there's something deeply wrong here. And it's also clear to me that if transition is supposed to make trans people happier, on a large scale, it's not working. And when you've got suicidality, rate of 50% or more, that tells me that this plan for making this group of people who are 50% suicidal isn't working. I mean, if that's not enough to convince you, I don't know what else to tell you. And one other final point that I'll make as well, because we've all these questions, and I appreciate the questions. I appreciate that you guys at least are coming up to talk to me. In most schools, they won't even do that. So I appreciate that. But all of these questions are about, well, this trans person says that they're happy. I say that I'm happy. Even if I were to concede that there may be some trans people who feel like they're happy, I think even then they're lying to themselves and there's a deeper despair there, which is what led them to reject themselves in the first place. But we could put that entirely to the side, because what I'd like to do is get back to the question of, is it true, okay? It might make a man, maybe there's a man out there who feels happier if we affirm him as a woman. Is it true though? Is it actually true? And I would say that the truth matters first before we get to the emotional questions. So I'll throw it back to you. Biological male says that he's a woman, wants to be affirmed as a woman. Is it true? Is the claim that he's making about himself, is it actually true?
Yes.
How? How do you know that?
How would you define a woman? Because you've asked other people up here to define how we would define a woman. How would you define a woman, Mr. Walsh?
An adult human female.
And how don't trans people, how doesn't a transgender woman fit that definition?
Female.
Because they're not female. They have, you said that you are a biological male, correct?
I said I'm transgender. I might be intersex for all we know. About almost as many people in the world are transgender as intersex. And
well,
a lot of people don't know.
Well, but that's a different conversation. Intersex, that's a genetic anomaly, that's a medical condition. So that's a completely different conversation. That's also not a third gender. That's just a genetic anomaly that occurs within the sex binary of male and female. What you're saying is that a quote unquote trans woman is a female.
By the definitions I'm familiar with, yes.
So how would you define female?
Through my training in healthcare, there are several different categories for how we define sex. People bring up chromosomes. People also bring up hormone levels. People bring up all sorts of other categories. Lots of people don't fit neatly into a gender binary, even people we don't consider to be intersex. It's a complicated spectrum.
It's not complicated, but you also didn't define. So what is a woman? What is a female? What do these words mean?
It's complicated, and I know you're not going to like that answer, but that's because there are no simple answers in human biology.
Let me ask you a question.
You guys,
Hang on.
Let me finish. You guys like to bring up high school level biology classes a lot. I get that a lot. But people who go on to more complicated biology classes will talk about sex as a spectrum.
It's not.
Well, biological researchers would disagree with you.
Well, then they're full of shit, the ones that would say that.
All right.
There are male gametes and female gametes. Oh, I had one last question.
Wait, Mr. Walsh, can I ask a question?
I just have one quick. Can you come back for 1 second? Because this is an important question. You said you're an EMT.
Yes.
Okay. If you're responding to a health emergency. Biological male, somebody with a penis, is having a medical emergency, and they say to you, "I think I'm having a miscarriage." Would you check them to see if they're having a miscarriage? Would you consider that a possibility for them?
Look. No, but that's because some people don't have body parts. Doesn't mean they're not a woman.
Okay. Sounds like we've established there are some people who, in principle, can get pregnant. And there are some people who can't. So there's two categories, otherwise known as binary.
Lots of women can't get pregnant either.
Yeah, but they're still of the nature to get pregnant. The only reason...
But they can't get pregnant.
Yes, but
truth matters, right?
It does. That's what I'm trying to explain to you.
Truth matters, and they can't get pregnant. That's the truth. So how are they still women?
Because they are... For the same reason that I can rightly say that human beings have two legs, and if a person is born with only one leg, that doesn't call into question the statement that human beings have two legs. Okay, a person being born with one leg doesn't mean that now legs are on a spectrum, and we can't say anything at all about how many legs a person has. Who knows? They could be a centipede. You know, they could have 100 legs. No, we know human beings have two legs. If a human is born without two legs, something went wrong. They were supposed to have that second leg. Something went wrong. If you meet a person on the street who only has one leg, maybe they had an accident. Maybe they were in war. Maybe they were in a car accident. Maybe they had cancer. A leg was cut off. But you know that something went wrong because by their nature, they're supposed to have two legs. Same thing for a woman. A woman by her nature can get pregnant. A man by his nature never can. So if you meet a woman of childbearing age, say she's 28 years old, and she can't get pregnant, you know automatically that something has gone wrong. And she can go to the doctor and find out what that thing is, even if they can't fix it. So that proves that women by their nature can get pregnant, because the simple fact that she can't shows you that there is something wrong. This is what is known as the exception that proves the rule. Whereas if a male with a penis can't get pregnant, no doctor on earth is going to run tests to see what's wrong with him. Because they already know it's that he's a male, and there's only male and female, those who can get pregnant and those who can't. So, all right, that's it. That's it.